Because of our a little gap with the soundless time period, we're going to hold off on Bilal's amazing song and see if we can squeeze it in later in the program. So you've already know that Resistance in Brooklyn, our affinity group and collective, has been doing this event for over 30 years, joined in recent years happily by ABC, the New York ABC Collective. Why? One reason is simply this. The holidays can be a hard time to be, an extra hard time to be behind bars. So communicating, sending something in, send even just like a frail piece of paper going through the mail and in through the bars, tells the prison authorities the prisoners are being watched on the outside. And it tells the people inside they haven't been forgotten and we're there for them. So that's a simple reason. Another reason is because as a collective that's trying to educate people about what it's like living in this country and what we need to do to change things here, repression is an important thing to let people know about. I mean, it's a sad but true fact that people who care passionately about clean water, passionately anti-war, are passionately against police brutality and for Black liberation, people who are passionately for Native American sovereignty can end up behind bars among many. And we can talk about strategies and tactics till the cows come in, and we will. But people who stand up for things in a serious and passionate way can end up behind bars. So repression is part of living in this country and wanting to change things, and we embrace that. It's part of understanding the state and the machine-like capacity of the state to protect the wealthy and to do tremendous injustices to the rest of us. Another reason we do this is because we've been asked to by, as a white anti-imperialist, anti-racist collective, we've been asked to take the case of political prisoners seriously by our friends in the Black liberation movement, the indigenous movement, and the movement of the Puerto Rican people for justice and independence. We've been asked that. And we do that as an anti, we listen to that request seriously as an anti-racist thing, as a moral thing, and also because those who face the brunt of the system end up often having the strongest strategies for changing the system. So those are three good reasons to listen and take that seriously. Bell Hooks, the recently late Bell Hooks, said, "The most basic activism we can have in our lives is to live consciously in a nation that's living in fantasies." And, or we could call it misinformation these days. And one of the things I think that happens often is we have a lot of built up cynicism and helplessness at the idea that our nonprofits, that our politicians, that the things that our nation holds as truths are not true and are motivated by greed. And people like political prisoners are clearly not motivated by greed. People who go out and block roads because they're protesting oil expenditures, people who defend water, people who have done the many different things our political prisoners have done in standing up for Black people, et cetera, they're not motivated by the profit margin. And that leads to a challenge to the cynicism of all of us, and it's an inspiration. So with that, let's go on to our inspiring party. And I'm sorry, the last thing I want to say is, we call it a card writing party because we have for years, but the draconian new policies about what you can send into prison mean that what we're recommending is you don't use anything but a Black pen on white regular paper and send it in a white regular envelope. That is it. This is the new challenge to our artistic expression. That's how we have to send things in. So, so there you go. And now on to Matt.
Wow, on to Matt. I thought that was going to be longer somehow, my dear. Okay, so because I'm busy, you know, like doing gossiping on the chat, but more than just gossiping, let me show my face here, and let me say that we are mainly putting into the chat some of the ways in which you can be, you know, doing this writing. So we're going to have a lot of updates here because we didn't think it was necessarily the most exciting thing to do, to, you know, to watch people write together. So we are, in fact, going to be hearing a lot of updates from a lot of people. And we're really honored to have, as the first person presenting, someone who's become really family in this past year. The fact of the matter is that for those paying attention, you'll know that Brother Jihad Abdul-Mumit is the national chair of the National Jericho Movement. You'll know that he's a former political prisoner, Black Liberation Army, Black Panther, although there's no former Black Panther, you know, once a panther, always a panther. And you'll know that he's also a playwright and a poet and a noted public speaker. You may also know that he's been one of the coordinators with myself, with Jaleel, with Dequi, with Sekou, with Eileen Weitzman, with Imo Quint, with Aisha Mohammed, of the Spirit of Mandela group and the International Tribunal. And Jihad's gonna talk about that tribunal right now and some of the visions post-tribunal. But I think it's worth saying that if any one of the coordinators needed to think about a glue, I jokingly would say a chairman, an operational center to hold us together and keep us moving forward, Brother Jihad really played that role. So it's with great honor and great respect, with admiration and love, that we introduce our first speaker, Jihad Abdul-Mumit, and there'll be two other speakers coming on quickly. And I'll say right now what's happening right after Jihad, so we can flow right one to the other. As soon as Jihad is done, we're going to hear from Sister Paulette, who we miss. You know, she used to live in New York City, and so those of us in New York who are used to this being in-person gatherings, we miss you, dear sister. So as soon as Jihad's done, without further introduction, Paulette's gonna give her piece. It's appropriate just because of her own long history, but also she's gonna be giving updates on Leonard Peltier. And in many ways, we like beginning and grounding our work. We're here, those of us in Brooklyn and New York, on Lenape land, and we're grounded about the land that we're on that was stolen from its original peoples. And then right after Paulette, again, before any other introductions, we're going to play a very brief 2-minute video that was just produced by some of the Spirit of Mandela youth, some of our young people. We're very proud of them. This is the first time anyone's going to be seeing this 2-minute video. It is a musical and video tribute to the fact that just 2 days ago was the 70th anniversary of the original We Charge Genocide petition to the UN. So we'll see that video. Before that, we'll see Sister Paulette. But right now, first and foremost, our beloved, our brother, our comrade, our friend, Jihad Abdul-Mumit, take it away, good sir.
Wow. Greetings of peace, everyone. Assalamu alaikum. Alhamdulillah. Praise be to Allah. Thank you so much for the introduction, Matt. And greetings definitely to all the new sisters and brothers I'm looking at who I may not know personally. You know, I'm honored to be in this space with you. So I guess to begin with the time I have to say, when it comes to letter writing to our freedom fighters that are in prison, it's very important that we maintain that communication, uplift their spirits, share information, even if it's just, you know, how your day went. You know, is so beautiful and powerful for us to read letters about what you're experiencing in the day. So if you're ever wondering, well, I'm going to say what I'm going to do, just say what you did throughout the course of the day. And it's very powerful for us to read those letters. I say us because many of us on the call have been in prison. You know, and as far as what Sister Meg said about how to write on blank paper, white paper, with the black pen, that's the era that we are in. I just want to say that I was at an annual board meeting, which I'm on the board of the Abolitionist Law Center, and that's one of the questions that was talked about amongst many other things, business item things, was challenging the communication management unit oppression that's imposed upon many of our freedom fighters, including Sister Afia Siddiqui, Eric King, Larry Hoover, Imam Malik, you know, many others that we can't even write to. There's so many things imposed. So your name came up, Daniel, in that meeting. And so I will be calling you because you might have some insight about how to proceed on that, my dear brother. So expect a call from me. But it is on the radar to challenge that because you can't say, well, that's the policy. Well, F the policy. We're going to try to change that so that can't be done anymore. You know, just to impose a letter writing restriction on someone, they cannot receive letters for years and years and years and years and years. No, 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 no. So regardless, we don't care that it being a law, we don't care it being a BOP policy, we don't care it being a DOC policy, you know, we're going to tackle that head on. And I know it's been tried different times before. So my comrade Daniels, expect that call from me, brother. Maybe you can build and you might have some insight for us on that. So that's coming from the Abolitionist Law Center, knowing that that's on the radar. So just briefly, you know, the tribunal, it served to prove what's already known by all of us, but we had to prove what's already been proven many times and many, and through our life experiences. It's been proven and lived out through literature, books, everything that's been written on the oppression and genocide of Black, Brown, and Indigenous people over 400 years. And so the tribunal served to educate the American public about what's already been proven so many times. But it was done in a political slash legal way to just bring all the information up to 2021 standard. And I hope that each and every one of us in our circles and our spheres of activity and action that we will be able to utilize the information from the verdict to, so I'm gonna say legitimize our struggles moving forward, but you know what I'm saying in the context of bringing your neighbor, your other family members, a political public up to speed on what's happening. So I hope you will find the information in the verdict and the tribunal very useful as ammunition and fuel to bolster our own efforts in fighting against oppression and exploitation, you know, in our own circles. So if you hear what I'm saying, you have to really cut into that and don't let it just be a passing event with you. All right, some of the outcomes of that, yes, we will be taking it to court because it was a violation. Genocide is a statute against that, believe it or not. 18 U.S.C. 1091, you'll read it. It parrots the 1948 U.N. Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of Genocide. So the United States stands to be charged. It stands to be punished. There's a punishment for that. You're killing people. There's a punishment for a homicide. There's no statute of limitation, even though the crime continues to exist structurally and systemically. Not just a police killing a brother, man, or sister, lady on the street corner, but the crime of genocide plays out in so many different ways. That is why we also had charged one of the elements as being environmental racism, beyond the police killings, beyond the mass incarceration, beyond the reality of our freedom fighters in prison for decades. We did charge and bring into the stage environmental racism and racism and health disparities too. So this is a very comprehensive, this was a recharged genocide from 70 years ago on steroids. So I hope we latch into it and make use of it in its fullest way. We ask that you dispatch somebody from your organization, you yourself, to be a part of the continued operations and post-tribunal initiatives, including building of a People's Senate, which is what I want to land on and speak just a couple of minutes on, and then I'll close out. We are in a situation, very toxic environment right now, where we see the contradiction between the ruling class and its entities. You got the white supremacist reactionaries, or the Trumpers, for lack of a better way of putting it. And then we have the neoliberals on the other side. They're battling for the spoils and control of the capitalist system. And here we are, the people, the masses of people underneath. And as I constantly say, there's an old African proverb that says, when two horses fight, the grass underneath gets trampled, and we do stand to be trampled. I do understand the saying that repression beats resistance, but what does that mean to us in terms of our survival here in a place called the United States of America? So we don't want to take anything for granted. We really have to put our work in terms of really organizing. So what this Senate seeks to do, amongst other things, it seeks to educate people, but it seeks to organize to organize, you know, so that we can be in a position to not only represent the true needs of the people.
Ready to try? It ain't time yet.
It not only stands to represent the true needs of the people and educating them at the same time, but it also seeks to really network organizations and formations down south, northeast, the west coast, the middle, Midwest, you know, to be able to form a representation of people. So that we don't turn around and we'll be so discombobulated and disorganized, functioning in our own silos of 20 and 40 people. What is our reach anyway? We really need to think on a much more visionary, you know, where are we gonna be in this place 5 years from now? You know, it does encompass and embrace the fact of freeing political prisoners. But you know, sisters and brothers, when we say free all political prisoners, when we demand the release of our political prisoners, you do know, I hope you do know, that the state doesn't care about that. And one reason that it doesn't care about that is just real talk to you guys, is that we haven't built a movement strong enough to make them care about that. The way sisters and brothers have been getting out of prison for the most part, and there's exceptions, there are exceptions, okay, to that, because our momentum has played a role. So I'm not discounting that, but for the most part, you know, it comes down to strategic letter writing, you know, attorneys and doctors in the right place and time, Sister Dr. Barbara Zeller testifying, and you know, Maroon Schultz talked, you know, that last compassion release hearing to get him out. These are like taking an arrow, as Matt has told me in a very good analogy. We only have so many arrows in our sheath. You know, we got the people demonstrating and all that, that's fine, but we really target strategy, taking an arrow out your sheath, you know, pulling it back, right? And picking the right target and letting that go to get the exact result of getting a freedom fighter out of prison. A demonstration on the street corner with 200 people is not getting anybody out of prison. It's only important to organize and educate people in the community. But for actually getting somebody out that's been there 50, 60 years, we're gonna have to come up with something very surgically precise. All right, we have to come up with short-term strategies and long-term strategies. All right, long-term strategies. Now we got to get them out now. Yeah, of course we do. That's why we have these short-term strategies. But the People's Senate is an initiative to build up a momentum amongst people that even your grandmother will know about, Sundia Okoli. You know, we need to do this in a long-range visionary way. We need to be able to cut into more mainstream society. Yes, the country and the land that we live in, beyond our revolutionary circles, to really be able to educate people, educate the masses of people, not sing to the choir of other revolutionaries and activists, but to be able to, you know, and so that language has to be very strategically and critically thought out, sisters and brothers. You know, that's why we're not calling it a Black United Front, because that represents, in my humble opinion, to be discussed later, you know, failed initiatives that start, spark, and bloom and don't even exist anymore. We can't present that to the people. What we're presenting to the people is something. You have the United States Senate, you have the House of Representatives. People, even though they may know they're the oppressive organization, entities that don't represent them, but they acknowledge them as real entities. That's why we have strategically used the word People's Senate, to put it somehow in the psyche of the minds of the masses of people, not revolutionaries, the masses of people. Then damn the revolutionary, we're already there. We're talking about reaching the masses of people who does not resonate with terms like self-determination and even Black power anymore and capitalism. And you ask any young person, what they want to do for life. They're talking about being an entrepreneur. They're talking about making money. They're talking about getting a house. They're talking about going to college. They're talking about being a professional football player. They're talking about this and that. All of these things are connected with the capitalist system. All of these things, ask anybody that. So when you say anti-something and we haven't put together what we're talking about, this rhetoric is defeatism on our part. We got to fix the potholes first. We have to do something in the community first, and then comes the militant rhetoric. So then we use a term called the People's Senate. Oh my God, yes, something like that. that your parents can listen to, that your spouses and other people in your own family that doesn't even pay attention to what you're doing. You're a solo worker in your own family. Your sisters and brothers in the house that you stay at are not even paying attention to what you do. So the people sent it. Yes, something that's legally viable, something that makes sense. We revolutionaries know what it means. Are we willing to get on a trajectory, a projected strategy, it's well calculated and thinking this out, or are we going to emotionally fumble and tumble and try to do the same things as we've always been doing? So I'm asking you, I'm asking each and every one of you, as we're celebrating our comrades in prison, we're honoring and saluting Maroon Russell Schultz, who passed away, all these things, we're going to write our letters, and we have to write the letters, sisters and brothers. We have to write these letters during this time frame to uplift our freedom fighters. We have to do that. Maybe get our family members to do that. Sit at the kitchen table and just make it a fun thing. Turn on some good music and whatever. And we have to write these letters. I see Matt giving me the sign, but I'm asking you to dispatch anybody in your organization, if you haven't already, or you yourself, to tune in with the initiatives of the People's Senate and building these post-tribunal initiatives. If you're not involved with it yet, you can send a simple email to spiritofmandela1@gmail.com. Spiritofmandela1, because we botched the first email. So spiritofmandela1@gmail.com and say, hey, my name is Sister So-and-so. I want to become involved in this. Where can I go? Where can I fit? And you would do much to that. It is not asking you to abandon or abort your own missions and what you're doing, but it's asking you to become involved in this revolutionary initiative that's going on now. So I salute each and every one of you, my love and support. What's going on? Thank you, Meg, and thank you, Matt, for doing this. And thank you for calling me the last 10 minutes. I was playing with my cats, Matt. You caught me right on time. And I'm going to sit here and listen to all the wonderful things that everybody else has said. Thank you for your time. I greet you as I came with Assalamu Alaikum. Peace be upon you.
Thank you, Jihad. So a quick update, the Turkish comrades, their video went for about 25 minutes and then they ran into some technical problems. They're going to reschedule for next Sunday. As soon as they send the information, I will forward it to you. I talked to Connie Nelson, who has been in touch with Leonard more frequently than I have, and she said he is doing well. And what people are asking is that people write a letter, a short letter to Biden, to say that it's time for Leonard to come home, that while he is a political prisoner in the Indian Wars, he's also a father, grandfather, and now a great-grandfather, and that his family and community want him to be returned to share the knowledge that he has. And so many of you have written letters over the years, a small kind letter, a reminder to Biden that he's taken on this responsibility in Indian country and that he needs to step up for Leonard. And if you get it in the mail, we're hoping that there will be enough pressure besides what his lawyer has been able to do, Kenneth Sharp, who has made inroads in that an understanding that Leonard's release to the pardon attorney has actually made it to a real life person this time. After all these years where it's just sat on a desk, it's actually reached an attorney in that office. The other thing is, it's so wonderful to see all my sisters, Diane and Elspeth and Betsy, oh gosh, and Meg, Toby, I so miss you women. It's sort of isolated here in Daqui, so I hope you all have a wonderful holiday and you can get most updates on whoisleonardpeltier.info. So from here in the hills of Georgia, in the land of the Cherokee, I say thank you, Miigwech, and have a happy holiday.
I was arrested on August 28, 1971. I was not released until October 2020, 49 years and a few months. I am the one who initiated the call for this hearing, for this tribunal.
His case was denied not once, but three times in 2007 under false pretenses, as the American Embassy stated that we submitted false information, which was not true. And I have documentation of that.
Police are often conspirators with white supremacists who are largely doing the swatting when you talk about the swatting of Black radical organizers. I've been targeted by swatting over the last little more than a year, three times.
So I want to introduce New York City ABC. I'm not sure who's speaking for you guys, but this is a collective, part of a national movement of the ABC that have done tremendous work around the prisoners, raising money for commissary and supporting all of the prisoners and getting the information out. So somebody introduce yourself and speak.
So nice to see some faces. Yeah, and even though we're not physically together to write cards, hopefully folks are able to, you know, send one or two in to people inside. And yeah, thanks to RnB for all the work you're doing. We wanted to give an update on Daniel Baker, who recently went in, but I think to save time and to give a little bit of time for the guest speakers, we'll just put the information in the chat about his case and his address. Okay, thank you.
Savannah, that's great. And as usual, ABC is informative and also not taking the limelight. So fabulous collective. Okie doke. We're moving on to Dekwi Kioni Siddiqui, who I discovered, I've been spelling her first name wrong for a long time. She's a longtime activist for Black liberation, a representative of the Northeast Political Prisoner Coalition, a member of the Spirit of Mandela Coordinating Committee, and chair of the Malcolm X Commemoration Committee, co-editor with Matt Meyer of Look For Me in the Whirlwind from the Panther 21 to the 21st Century Revolutions, and a passionate poet. So, Dekwi.
Thank you, Meg. Hello, assalamu alaikum. Greetings to everyone who is here. I'm just so glad to be here, virtual or not. I mean, just seeing so many people, like what Paulette said, seeing Elsbeth. Oh my God, Elsbeth, I miss you. I just love so many other people here, and it's just,
I miss you too.
Thank you. It is just so absolutely wonderful to see folks here. And Meg, when you said the thing about something about some things being inspiring, to have Jan here, to have Sekou here, to have Daniel here, to have Jihad here, to have people who have been inside the wall because they were servants of the people, for them to be here with us on this virtual Zoom and doing this work, that is so very inspirational. And that's what helps me to be inspired. So for all, I'm sending love to all the folks that I know and those that I don't. I want to thank you for being here and choosing to spend this Sunday afternoon with us. So Meg asked me to look for a poem that I had written about families in prison. I can't find it. But what I did do is I kind of like remixed it a little to make it more contemporary. I found a poem that I read for a 2018 Bread and Roses Women's Poetry, Women Identified Poetry Slam. So I just want to share that. So, and it's just called Remix. America, this Frankenstein of white supremacy exists on stolen land. Its deadly shards of vulture capitalism, imperialism, colonialism drop bombs, drones, missiles, lead military invasions and occupations on nations of non-white people everywhere. Trail of Tears, Wounded Knee, Tulsa, Watts, Philadelphia, Syria, Newark, Iraq, Palestine, Harlem, Detroit, and beyond. As white settlers and their descendants drenched in the blood of indigenous genocide, African enslavement, Jim and Jane Crow apartheid, carry on with their lives, with their lies about making this never was America great again. While Herman Bell, since released, David Gilbert, since released, Jaleel Muntakeem, since released, Robert Seth Hayes, released and since deceased. But while Sundiata Okoli, Imam Jamil Alameen, Dr. Mutulu Shakur, Veronica Bowers, Ed Poindexter, and Kamal Siddiqui all continue to be held captive behind prison death camp cells, walls, and towers, longer than millennials have been alive, but simply daring to struggle to really make America great, not again, but for the first time. And not just for the white settler class, but for all the people who everywhere and somewhere on this stolen land are having their bodies, lives, families, and communities ripped apart, shattered, shredded, and mangled to pieces by 1, 8, 19, 41, 80, hundreds even, or even thousands of rounds of centuries-old unpunished police bullets dipped in the red, white, and blue of racist star-spangled injustice and the declarations of war it wages on Black liberation, drugs, terror, and immigration as every president, living or dead, from George Washington to Barack Obama to the Orange Man to the current one, continues to legislate, sanction, justify, rationalize, and mandate poverty, homelessness, tyranny, repression, exploitation, oppression, and terror as the natural order of things, while and demonstrating to the world that from the youngest to the oldest, Black, brown, and indigenous children understand early in life that on this stolen Turtle Island renamed America, in practice, policy, and law, it's only white lives and blue killer cop lives that matter. And so this poem is my freedom chant to speak into existence a 21st century remix of the brothers and sisters who made up the 7 days, the African Blood Brotherhood, Deacons of Self-Defense, Republic of New Africa, New African Independence Movement, real life Black Panthers, who made a way out of every way to rebel, imagine, create, organize, and lead a movement for self-determination, independence, and resistance. And so on this day and every day, let us not forget to include the freedom of our political prisoners as an essential part of every demand we make for justice, human rights, and our own freedom. Thank you. Thank you. And so I just want to say to folks, I spoke to Teresa this morning, because Sekou and I can't make it to his janazah, to Maroon's janazah tomorrow. And she just was extolling her gratitude and appreciation for all the people who have worked on her dad's behalf across decades, whether it was protests, letter writing, the MXCC dinner, all the ways in which she said that we have the people, these people here and now, and those who have gone on, and those who are not in this space right now, have made a way for her father to not cross over to the other side behind the prison wall. So I'm just extending her gratitude and appreciation. And she said that she is feeling good about the fact that her father was home when the Creator called him back. So thank you. Thank you for this opportunity to be here. I love you all. Thank you so much.
Chills, Dequi, as always. Thank you so much. Next up is Daniel McGowan, an environmental activist and former political prisoner, and someone who's come out and looked at the overall situation and dedicated much of his time to the entire array of the serious political prisoners with the long sentences from the movements of people of color. So Daniel, and also, how could I forget, he's the one of the editors of the Certain Days calendar, which I am quite sure he's going to let you know how you can get for next year.
Great. Thank you, Meg. I appreciate it. I just want to just ask, am I speaking about Eric and the released prisoners right now, or what's your preference?
Well, if you can keep it to like three-ish minutes,
yeah.
Let us know how we can buy the calendar.
Sure.
Let us target who you want to say.
We want everything. We want everything in 3 minutes. Everything in 3 minutes. Absolutely.
I'll do my best. I'll do my best. I speak really fast, so I'll just go on normal speed. All right. Well, thank you for having me. I appreciate it. That was a nice introduction. I do work with the Certain Days Collective, and I've been coming to these parties since about 2003. I was gone for 7 years, and I was a recipient of these wonderful homemade painted cards that were made every year for a while. I will just give you a heads up how to get the Certain Days Collective calendar for 2022. The best way to get it is through burningbooks.com. But if you go to certaindays.org, there is a list of stores and different places like AK Press, Just Seeds, Chris Blebedeb, Left Wing Books, leftwingbooks.net, whatever. So that's a really easy way to get it. And if we were in person, I would have them in my backpack and be selling them to you myself. The proceeds from the calendar go to a bunch of different groups like RAP, Adamir, Abolitionist Law Center has received money, Amistad Law Project, CLDC, all kinds of stuff. So hopefully people can just check out certaindays.org. That's the easiest way. So I'm going to give you a brief update about Eric King. He is a younger political prisoner currently in the federal system. He is facing up to 20 years at a trial in March 2022. Eric was assaulted by a BOP lieutenant at FCI Florence 2 years ago and defended himself for about like a second. And, of course, was then charged with assault. He's been held for over 1,250 days in segregation at FCI Englewood. And he's been on a near total mail ban for over a year, about a year and a half now. He can only receive letters from immediate family and his lawyers currently. Recently, Eric was got a little bit of a court victory in that some statement he made at a discipline hearing about the incident was suppressed by the judge. And so he will be going to trial in March 14th, 2022. He is committed to going to trial. There's been no reasonable plea offer at all. He has no interest in taking any because he feels he was called into the lieutenant's office and then basically put in a horrible situation and defended himself against violent assault and now is facing up to 20 years for that. I threw in the chat all the good links about Eric King and his address. So he cannot receive letters, but he can receive books and magazines, and he reads quite extensively. We have like a little wish list for him that's in one of those links. So I'll shut up about Eric now, but thank you for paying attention to his case. ABC and Jericho has obviously been very supportive of Eric. And I have, since I got out, in a desire to just deal with the dread and the tedium of sometimes what this work offers and post-incarceration feelings, I have just compiled a released political prisoner list for the last 10 years. And I keep it up to date, and I'm always very excited when people come home. So I'm just going to do a roll call shout out for the people that I have that have been released in 2021. I'm sorry if anyone is left out of it. And if you want the whole document, I will just, hold on. I send it to friends when we're feeling particularly down about everything to be like, look, like it's not great, but we definitely have some victories, right? So I'm going to just roll call this real quick. I'm not going to give dates, but it's all for 2021. Michael Marcus, also known as Rattler, was released in 2021. Father Steve Kelly from the Kings Bay Plowshare. Jan Lamont. Excellent, amazing, still stuns me that he's out. Martha Hennessy from the Kings Bay Plowshare. Joshua Stafford of the Cleveland Four. Carmen Trotta from the Kings Bay Plowshares. Reality Winner. Claire Grady and Patrick O'Neill from the Plowshares, also Mark Colville, and David Gilbert. And also, I just want to note, there's one political prisoner died in custody this year. That is Romaine Chip Fitzgerald, one of the longest serving political prisoners in the United States, and a Black Panther. And obviously, Russell Moreno Jones received, can people mute their line if they're not talking? Russell Maroon Schultz was released on compassionate release in October and passed away on the 17th of December. So, you know, if we were in person, people, maybe we'd be clapping and shouting out, but, you know, I just wanted to make sure that that list got covered. And I'm sorry if anyone was excluded, but that would be my fault if so. So thank you, everyone.
Well, thank you, Brother Daniel. That was sobering and inspiring and wonderful as always, and it's always wonderful to have you with us and helping organize us. I really don't have words. I mean, I had words for introducing Jihad, but I don't really have words for introducing our next speaker. Another recently released political prisoner. We know from examples like Baba Sekou and others that people, you know, are itching, are thirsty to get to work quickly when they get out, despite their years behind bars. But one might think that when one is captured as a young man, as the following speaker, Jalil Muntakim, was, and especially when one has spent close to 50 years behind bars, that one might take a little bit of time, just a little bit of time to step back and breathe and learn about the new world that they're in. It is true, we kind of knew that Jalil was never exactly a typical person. I mean, from inside the prison walls, he helped birth the Jericho movement. He came up with a vision for a Spirit of Mandela coalition, which then gave form to the International Tribunal. We did not expect, though, frankly, that he would quickly fit in, not just as a visionary. We knew that that would take place, but as an actual, just basic hand-to-hand, door-to-door, knocking on the doors, sending the emails, getting on the Zooms, organizer. So it has been not only a pleasure to have him in our midst, but an honor, but also just a functional coolness that, you know, another hand on deck, another worker, another organizer with Jihad and Dequi and myself and others is this member of the coordinating committee helping to move things forward and all those other visionary things that poet, writer, former political prisoner, Jalil Muntakim is. Baba Jalil, take it away. The floor is yours. And by the way, I'll say this, right after Jalil, we're going to hear that tape from David Gilbert as well, who can't be with us today live, but is giving his first tape message since release, other than a 3-second thing he gave to the Great Parole Pardon Project. But David's tape will come right after Jalil. But Baba Jalil, an honor to have you here. Welcome. And take the floor, please.
Assalamu alaikum to everyone. Peace, paz, Rabar Gandhi, and every other Guten Tag and any other language that offers the idea of peace and solidarity. I'm grateful for this opportunity just to, I like to clear up a few things, right? you know, in that clip, the last clip you just saw, I said at the tribunal that I'm the initiator of the International Tribunal. And I want to make some comments about that. In as much as the idea for the international jurors came from me in 2018 while I was locked up in a solitary confinement at Southport Correctional Facility, the real work, the on-the-ground work from the issues of from what I originally proposed to what actually accomplished was Jihad, it was Matt, it was Sekou. It was the brothers and sisters out here doing that work while I was inside. And so it is important for us to acknowledge that, that the idea of building from what I initiated or what I proposed to what we have and what we accomplished was the work of this strong and deep commitment from our comrades who was on the streets already before I even reached. So for me, and what Matt says about getting involved, getting engaged, the couch was already prepared for me to have a sit down. Okay, they prepared that couch for me to have a sit down and sit at the table and be able to contribute in the capacity that I am up here in Rochester. It is important for us to also understand that the vision, primary vision that is being espoused, promoted and propagated by Jihad and Matt is extremely important, particularly in respect to building the People's Senate. Why is that important? Because we have to create a new narrative in regards to what is happening here in this country and our relationship to how we are governed and being governed. And in this instance, this new narrative, we have to recognize that both the corporate party, Democratic and Republican Party, do not work in the interest of us, right? They work in the interest of the corporation, right? And we got to understand the United States is in fact itself a corporation. And by virtue of that alone, we note that corporations operate for one thing and one thing only, for profits, right? And they put profits over people. The United States government in its ways operate primarily from profits over people. And who are the profits going to? Here in the United States, it's going to 544 billionaires who controls the wealth of this country. 544 billionaires, let's get this understand. That's about 28,000 families. Right, they control the wealth of $2.6999 trillion, all the wealth of Western Europe, in the hands of 544 people in a population, American population, of 330 million. If that's not a disconnect, I don't know what is. Occupy Wall Street talked about the one percenters, right? That is the reality of the situation that we're confronting today, right? Not only that, the one percenters, but the whole idea of white supremacy. We know that we live in a white supremacist country. Right. What happened on January 6th was not only a provocation, it was designed, right? It was organized. It was organized by a person who had been the president of the United States, right? Trump. And he's coming back in 2024. He's going to split this country asunder. He'll split it in part, right? And we have to be prepared for that. We have to give full understanding and recognition to that. Building the People's Senate is part of the process for which we defend ourselves against what is going to be a serious splitting of this country, right? In terms of how we're governed and who governs us, right? I think for the most part, the majority of us are tired of being governed by a corporation, right? To be wage slaves to the corporation, right? And we need to figure out new ways, new ideas in terms of how we govern ourselves. Listen, the United States government came into existence by a handful of white men, right? So you're gonna tell me that we cannot change this condition from which we live in by hundreds, maybe thousands of activists across this country organized in the People's Senate? I think we can. I'm looking forward to my opportunity to contribute to that development as part of a process and the ideas that we are, in fact, our own liberators. Thank you for this opportunity to speak to you. And inshallah, we will be able to move forward and towards building this People's Senate and contradicting and preparing for what we believe is going to happen in 2024, leading up to 2024. 2022 is the year for reorganizing and for us to build the People's Senate. Assalamu alaikum, Abdullah.
Wa alaikum salam. It is David Gilbert.
It's so indescribably delightful to be able to relate to this great holiday card writing tradition and event that you all have carried out, RnB, ABC, and many other good people and friends, to be able to participate and relate to it from outside of the walls and the razor wire. Just want to let you all know that what you do makes a big difference, to the people inside. And we all can celebrate some important victories on releases of political prisoners in the past few years. And as we know, we still have a long way to go. But the work is important and valuable. recognizing and fighting to release political prisoners as a spearhead in the broader overall struggle as we all continue to work, fight for, and achieve a humane and sustainable world.
Yay! All right, just take a minute to breathe that in. And thanks for all the work that led to David's release. All of you people. And now, Deb, were you able to get a little information for us from the Schultz family?
Yes. Okay. There was a GoFundMe that had been active for the family that is no longer active, but I got in touch with Teresa and she gave me an address for that if people want to send donations to the family, they can send it to that. And I can, how about I'll just put it in the chat instead of saying it out loud, I'll put it in the chat so people can find it. I can also put the information about the services tomorrow there as well for anybody who didn't receive that information. I think that's about it. I don't have too much else to add, really.
I just want to say that I forgot to say that Deb Engels is a member of Resistance in Brooklyn Collective, and her dad has for many years been a friend and lawyer to Russell Maroon Schultz. And Russell Maroon Schultz, a longtime political prisoner, was recently released on compassionate leave with tremendous health issues. He should have been released much, much, much sooner. And he was an amazing spirit, warrior, writer, activist from inside. He worked with young people who were isolated in the SHU. He's an amazing person. And another person who's worked a long time passionately on his case is Benjamin Barson, who is also an activist and an amazing musical cultural worker, I'm going to say, because, you know, he's a musician, but he's also a worker in the world of making political culture. So Benjamin Barson, we're going to just have some time with him and his music as a way of feeling Russell Maroon Schultz's passing.
Thank you so much, Resistance in Brooklyn, and all of the amazing revolutionaries here, those who have served time behind bars fighting for our collective liberation and those fighting to liberate those behind bars to advance the struggle. I would be lying if I said it's not humbling to be here. I hope to channel some of the same energy that has been brought to this Zoom space. And I'm also, really grateful to Resistance in Brooklyn for continuing this tradition even, and continuing it in a very health conscious way as global pandemics and capitalism ravage our planet and our health. I just wanted to say a couple of words about Russell Maroon Schultz because this may be the only opportunity I really get to do so in a space like this. I just want to acknowledge that him being released by a state intent on killing him was an enormous victory, but it also is somewhat of a complex one because the state was successful in giving him cancer. It appeared to try to kill him earlier with either deliberate or at least extremely negligent conditions in which he contracted COVID-19 and managed to recover from. As the 2013 lawsuit, which the Abolitionist Law Center filed against his unconstitutional holding and 23 consecutive years in solitary confinement, his only disciplinary infraction since 1982 was that he had covered up a cold vent in his cell with a cloth in order to warm up his room. So, you know, it's quite clear that, you know, this was the full power of the state and the legacies of COINTELPRO intent on destroying this brilliant and committed revolutionary man and mind. And one of the reasons that Maroon was inspiring and important to me and so many was is that he was looking at the internal causes of why the movement, you know, had suffered from internal contradictions in the past. And one of the conclusions he came to was that patriarchy and sexism and machismo, including his own, had harmed and poisoned the cause. As he wrote in his essay, Respect Our Mothers, Stop Hating Women, which is in the collection of essays titled Maroon the Implacable, which Matt Meyer wrote an afterword for, I believe. He said, nevertheless, after becoming politically conscious, I further deluded myself into believing that being a revolutionary made me a champion dedicated to the uplifting of all humanity. It turned out, however, that I had just transferred many of my women-hating practices into another arena. That's the special fate of male revolutionaries who put so much stock into testosterone-dominated armed struggle. And I found Maroon's honesty and self-criticism, as well as his instruction to male revolutionaries such as myself, to be extremely inspiring and informative. Maroon is a matriarchal and was and is and continues to be a matriarchal revolutionary man. He developed a political vision of matriarchy that not only moved past patriarchy and the state as an instrument of male violence, but also rejected macho militancy and also rejected the classic seizure of state power in favor of an emphasis on prefiguration, on commoning, on creating collective resources, on democratic decentralization and accountability, focused on food security and sovereignty. And perhaps finally, and most importantly, Maroon left such a powerful impact in the community of prisoners and activists who have had consistent communication and mentorship with him. In my 11 years of organizing for Maroon, whether at hearings on solitary confinement in Philadelphia or in self-organized study groups in New York or eco-socialist gatherings in Jackson, meeting prisoners who are mentored by Maroon has always been a striking and humbling experience. The level of self-awareness, of commitment to bettering oneself and their community they are a part of, is something that all of these individuals carried with them. As Maroon told one of his mentees at one of these hearings I went to, you have to be better than the guards that oppress you on the inside. The communities who have been touched by Maroon bring his spirit and the most transformative elements of the Black liberation movement into the future, making his legacy a living one. And so on that note, I'm going to just play a small song in honor of Maroon and all of those who have been fighting for this to free this land for hundreds of years.
And Ben, you need to be done by at least 5:20, right? Yeah. Fox, thank you so much for your words. Thank you so much, Ben. Now we are going to hear from two people. We have a special guest visitor. We're going to hear from Sophia Elijah. And I wanted to make sure I was getting some of her different titles absolutely correct. Sophia Elijah has worked on the cases of the political prisoners all during her legal career, from when she was the head of the Criminal Justice Institute at Harvard through to now, where she's working with the Friends and Families Alliance. And she can correct me on that. I'm not sure I'm getting the title that correct. But a lifelong commitment both to the law and to the defense of the political prisoners. And she's here to speak about Sundiata's situation. And then afterwards, Sekou will put in a few words. He is a former political prisoner who's recently been released, a dedicated leader from his time as one of the Panther 21 through his rearrest and time in prison in New York State, and through being released and founding the Northeast Political Prisoner Coalition. So first Sophia and then Sekou.
Hi, good evening. How are you? Thanks for having me. I also want to join in expressing condolences to Maroon's family. I had many opportunities to visit with him, and his transition is a huge loss for all of us. He and Sundiata were very close, and in fact, Sundiata wrote a poem for him today. I'll speak briefly about Sundiata's current situation. I won't go over all the legal background of his case because that just takes too long. He's currently awaiting scheduling of oral argument before the New Jersey Supreme Court, appealing one of his many denials for release on parole by the New Jersey Parole Board. In total, he's been denied release on parole 8 times. This go round in this series of appeals, we have 7 teams of amicus lawyers who had filed briefs in support of his release, including a group of national Black law enforcement organizations. This is the first time he's received this level of support, and he's also enjoyed this time quite a bit of positive media coverage. Simultaneously, within the next few weeks, we will be filing a formal clemency petition with Governor Murphy, pushing for him to exercise his executive power to release Sundiata. Many of you know Sundiata will turn 85 on January 14th, and he has been incarcerated for over 48 years. He's serving his time in a federal facility in Cumberland, Maryland, a medium security facility, even though he's serving a New Jersey state sentence. Meg, that's the basic background. I don't know if you want me to say more or entertain some questions. And just to clarify, I'm currently the executive director of the Alliance of Families for Justice, which is a New York State organization headquartered in Harlem, whose mission is to support, empower, and mobilize families who have incarcerated loved ones and people who have justice involvement.
Thanks for doing that. Does anyone have any questions? I was looking particularly at what are ways that we enter into this current stage? And maybe that's for you, or maybe that's for Sekou. Anyone? Sure. Anyone with a question, or do you want to just answer that question, then we'll see if someone comes up with something else?
Yeah, why don't I answer that? And then I certainly can answer other questions. And Sekou, I'm sure, will have additional things you want to add. So Sundiata has a new website. I'll start with that. Sundiata Akoli FC for Freedom Campaign. So sundiataakolifc.org. There you can find out all the updated information on his case and the campaign. We are in the midst of a petition campaign and a postcard campaign. We've gathered over 17,000 signatures on the petition. People can find the link to the petition on the website. They can also find the link to have a postcard sent to Governor Murphy in their name on the website. those are the two things that we really need a lot of help with. The more signatures we can gather and the more postcards we can gather, the better. We are planning an event in January on the 13th to deliver the petition to Governor Murphy. Stay tuned for more of the details. We're you know, drilling down on the logistics now. Obviously, weather will be a factor in how we plan the delivery of the petition. And certainly the more postcards we can gather, the better. We're planning for a full push between now and Sundiata's 85th birthday, which I said is on the 14th of January. The last thing I will say, this is not something people can do, but people should be aware of. In the next few days, I think it will be probably before Christmas, on the New Jersey Turnpike, we'll have a huge billboard up calling for Sundiata's release, and it will be up for 4 months.
Wow.
I would love to go. I'm in New Jersey. I'd love to go to deliver the petition. Sophia, would you put your email contact or should I go to the website?
The details will be on the website. So okay. That's probably just, as I don't have them right now. Like I said, we're drilling down on the logistics. Okay. And the delivery of the petitions is going to be led by Elder Reverend Herbert Daughtry and other elders. And other clergy, and then other lay people, of course. But they're going to be in the forefront because this focus is on Sundiata's age.
Sophia, thank you so much for coming to this and sure. Presenting us with the information. A minute to kill time. I would just like to say, if we were in person doing the card writing party, some of the things that I miss, the beautiful lights out of Elspeth's windows, her beautiful large plants, Daniel's pickled fried pickles, and the mad rush to the kitchen when Toby finally parks her car and brings up the quiche to see who gets the quiche. So I'm just like, you know, spreading a little of my memories on the occasion. And here we go. Ready for you, Sekou, if you are ready for us.
Oh, okay. Assalamu alaikum, peace, power to the people. Matt knocked me off of my stand. I was already on this here email, but Matt called me and knocked me off to ask me to make a few comments. Here I am. I'm happy though to be here and to make a few comments, especially about my comrade Sundiata Kobe, who has been down now for 48 years, co-defendant of Assata Shakur, who was on that turnpike that fateful day in 73 when our comrade Zay Malik Shakur was assassinated while he sat in the back seat of the car, and Assata was attempted to be murdered, shot while her arm was up, and Sundiata also was wounded, you know. But he survived it and is still surviving after 48 years in prison for fighting back and resisting his own murder. The officer that tried to kill him, he actually was able to fight and take the gun from him. And in the process of them wrestling for the gun, the officer himself was shot and killed. And so of course they charged him with that murder. But Sundiata has always been one of the kindest, the most gentle, most loving, intelligent brothers you'll ever meet. He's always been working for the people, working to help people. I've did time with him in prison in three different joints. And in each of those joints, he was always trying to help someone else. He's a mathematician who worked for NASA before he was captured. And he always used his skills in math to help others in the joint who were in school, who were in college, or in some other educational programs to pull their own self up and help them in that area, myself included. Yeah, I was forced to take a educational class where they gave me algebra, and I remember absolutely nothing about algebra. And he tutored me, and I passed it. So, but I'll just say that, just to say that the brother is one of those who always worked to help others, and he's been down now. He's 84 years old. We need to bring him home. He really needs to come home. His health is failing him. But he's still strong spiritually. He calls me regularly. His spirit is strong. He still have hope and faith that we're going to bring him home. He's always counting on us to bring him home. He always talks to me about what we're doing to help others and himself also. And so I know he still have faith that we're going to bring him home. Let's not make him, let's make that faith come true. Let's bring him home as we need to bring all our political prisoners home to, one of the things that I always say is that a nation in struggle against oppression has to remember their freedom fighters, has to make their release paramount. That's number one demand throughout the world. If you go to any revolutionary country, any oppressed country that is fighting for their freedom, their political prisoners, their prisoners of war, are their number one demand that they must be released. We must release our prisoners. We must release Sundi Ata Coley. We must release Kamal Siddiqui. We must release Ed Poindexter. We must release all of our political prisoners and prisoners of war. Bring them home. It's past time. They not only are our political prisoners, but they are our elders. This is hundreds of years of history, of knowledge that they're holding from our communities. We need to bring that home and use it to free our people. So I think they told me I had three minutes. I think that's probably my 3 minutes. But so I say, let's bring them all home and let's definitely remember Sundi Ata Coley, our 84-year-old elder who needs to be home with us. Free them all.
Free them all. Thank you so much.
Thank you and for the opportunity.
So we are, on that note, we're going to Betsy for a brief Mumia update. We're going to cover a few of the other prisoners whose cases are pretty key right now. Betsy. I'm sorry. I'm going to introduce Betsy. Betsy Mickel is a longtime member of the Resistance in Brooklyn Collective, and she has dedicated a tremendous amount of her time to Mumia's case and the work around freeing Mumia.
Thank you. It's an amazing experience being here today. As for Mumia, he just passed the 40-year mark, December 9th of the incident in Philadelphia where he was shot and Faulkner was shot. And there's going to be, next summer, there's going to be a 40th anniversary of his sentencing on July 3rd in Philadelphia. And I tuned in last week. There was a webinar on Thursday, December 9th, and then on the 11th, there was a march in the streets of Philadelphia. And I wasn't able to be on the webinar, but I looked at it later thinking that I would learn something about the legal case from Lynn Washington, who's usually, well, nobody is on top of it right now, to tell you the truth, nothing is happening. But he did say something that resonated with me, and that is that Mumia has always been badly served by judges. And so I thought I would remind people, maybe you all have read it and seen it, back in the year 2000, Amnesty International did a report about Mumia's trial. It's called USA, A Life in the Balance, the case of Mumia Abu-Jamal. And they go over it point by point, what happened to him in the courtroom and before and after. So it's online. It's a PDF online. You can find it online if you want to. If you want to go back and read it either for the first time or the 12th time. There's also going to be an event of the larger Mumia mobilization for Mumia is going to be doing some event for Black History Month this year. So stay tuned. And that's all I have to say right now.
Thanks,
someone
Betsy.
to write to him.
Thanks, Betsy. And now I'm going to call on Robert Lederer, who's a longtime member of the Resistance in Brooklyn collective, and has also been working with the Matulu Committee. Bob, an update on Matulu.
Thanks, Meg. And welcome, everyone. Good evening. Well, Dr. Matulu Shakur is yet another brilliant Black elder who whose life is at severe risk and needs to come home immediately. Just before I get to the current details, many people may not know or may not remember some of the amazing achievements of him, particularly in the 1970s, but also for decades since then. He was the creator of the National Task Force on COINTELPRO Litigation and Research, which brought forward a very important lawsuit against COINTELPRO and their illegal activities. He was one of the founders of the National Black Human Rights Coalition, which organized a very broad front to highlight the issues of human rights. And then, of course, what he is known for, justly, as his perhaps most crowning achievement of the 70s, was playing the key role in the Lincoln Detox grassroots community experiment in alternative healing using acupuncture and Chinese medicine against all manner of addictions, whether to substances or alcohol, cigarettes, et cetera, which saved and transformed the lives of thousands and thousands of primarily people of color in the South Bronx, where it was located at Lincoln Hospital, but also people flocked from the entire region. So he was the director of the acupuncture component of that vital program that survived for 7 years until it was disbanded by the mayor, Ed Koch. And just one last thing, since he's been in prison, he's come forward with a visionary proposal for a Truth and Reconciliation Commission to deal with and heal from the illegal legacy of COINTELPRO. And that's still today is a very, very important proposal. So now to talk about what his situation is, he's at age 71. He was sentenced in 1986 to 60 years. He served 35 of those years. He's been denied parole 9 times. And most egregiously and flagrantly in violation of federal law, he was denied release that was mandated in 2016. He had served sufficient time to be released, except for people that they deem to have committed infractions in the prison. And they cooked up a completely phony, quote unquote, dirty drug test, which was not true, in order to deny him release. And so now he's seeking humanitarian release. He's seeking, as some of the others we've heard about tonight, either compassionate release by the Bureau of Prisons or presidential clemency from Biden. So rather than me kind of explain what you can do, let me share my screen. And this is a 30-second video. There's no sound on this, but it's good information, and I'll put the link to it in the chat. This is created by the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement, which has been one of the leading groups doing support work for Dr. Shakur for the entire time, really, that he's been incarcerated. So let me try this and see if it works. Oh, the host disabled screen sharing. Can you re-able that, Meg? or Matt?
Try it now.
Okay, 1 second. Let me move the screen. Is that visible? Can folks read it? The big print, not the small print.
It's going to be hard, but it's not going to get better than that. So just press play and let's move on.
Okay. And I'll read for those who can't read the text, I'll read the key headlines as we go. So he served his time. He's been denied staggering 976 days of earned good time. His health is worsening. He suffered a long list of conditions that are life-threatening, including cancer. He's calling for corrective clemency now. And then there's information on where you can write, email, and so forth. So like I said, I'll put this in the chat. I know that went by really fast, but it's good information compiled by the Malcolm X Grassroots Movement. And let's free Mutulu and free them all. Thank you.
Diana Crowder, who is, I'm proud to say, a member of the Roses and Bread Women's Cultural Action Collective, as well as many other important organizations, is going to be giving us, and she can say some of them herself. I'm sorry, I don't have them all. She's going to give us a brief message about Julian Assange.
Thank you for giving me this time. I have attended many, many Christmas card writing parties, and it's wonderful to be here again and see all your great faces and new faces. So Julian Assange, he spent 7 years in asylum in the Ecuadorian embassy. And then he's currently in Belmarsh Prison in the UK, where he's been for about 2.5 years. The US is trying to extradite him to the US. They've charged him under the Espionage Act for revealing all those documents that have told about war crimes in Iraq and Afghanistan and many other things. So the latest thing is, a judge said he could not be extradited. She upheld the charges, but he could not be extradited because of the conditions in US prisons. So even a judge in the UK knows what US prisons like, what solitary confinement is like, how torturous and inhumane, and that he wouldn't survive. He wouldn't survive even being held while the court case was going on. However, that was appealed, and on December 10th, a few days ago, two judges decided, yes, he could be extradited. And the lawyers for Assange and his family, they will appeal to the equivalent of the Supreme Court in the UK. Interestingly enough, during the Obama administration, while Biden was vice president, they investigated charges and against Assange and decided not to prosecute him, because if they did, then they would have to prosecute other folks and other journalists and publishers who'd done the same thing as Assange has done, including the New York Times. Then comes along Trump, who, you know, the press is the enemy of the people, period, unless it's Fox News, and he continued to persecute Assange with this extradition. Trump's gone, now is Biden, and Biden's made no move to do anything different. He does say that his Justice Department is going to renew its commitment to freedom of the speech, but has not done anything to show that he's going to do that. So please, if you're interested, I know people are working on other political prisoners and other work, but if anybody's interested to collect signatures to Biden, to help identify clergy, and to visit elected officials, we would really appreciate that. And yes, if you'd like to send him a Christmas card, please do that too. Thank you again so much.
Assange has also suffered a minor stroke.
Yes, during the court case, he had a mini stroke. I mean, anybody who sees the pictures of him from when he went into the embassy to now, you can see how his mental physical health has declined. Any questions, comments? Thank you again.
Thank you, Diana, for bringing it to our attention, like someone who's repressed by the U.S. and potentially one of the political prisoners here.
Yeah.
This is the moment when I wanted to check and see if anybody has been actually focusing on drawing their letters to the prisoners and would like to share a drawing. Children in particular are invited. Others who are doing it. I know personally, I have been focused on emceeing, so my letters all remain to be written after this is over. But I just thought I'd take a minute and check. If not, we can move on. It's an honor to all of us that Jan Lahman, so recently released, from being a dedicated political prisoner, as Matt keeps saying, he's the only person who received letters at the card writing party and always wrote back year after year after year. Someone who was always commenting on the movement outside and being active. Someone whose organization before he went in was dedicated to anti-racist, anti-imperialist actions. Someone that we honor and respect is here to give us a closeout statement before we end with there'll be some culture at the end that will be from the tribunal as well. But Jan Lahman, welcome to this gathering. We are so glad to be hearing from you.
I'm very glad to be here. I'm glad to hear all the information and ideas that we've discussed for the past hour and a half or so. What we're doing here, and we all realize it, of course, but I do want to emphasize it. What we're doing here is really important. I mean, it's important work because several points, and they've already been mentioned, so I won't go into detail, but it's important to keep in mind what just writing a letter, sending a thought, sending some information, sending some solidarity, what that means. First of all, when political prisoners receive mail, support letters and greetings and so forth from individuals, organizations, that's very much registered by the prison officials and guards and so forth. You know, when they come by and give you 15, 20 or 40 or letters or whatever, you know, they look at that and they know that this means something. So in that sense, it's not only the words and the thoughts and the solidarity and the spirit, but it's also a literal way of helping that prisoner, that political prisoner, that person, that sister or brother, avoid potential everything from physical attacks to setups. And we've been hearing about different situations, different people, you know. And let's be very clear about this. I also want to mention this. No political prisoner, you know, regardless of what particular area of the struggle they come from, they wind up in captivity. No political prisoner that faces the so-called in-prison infractions or rule violations are actually breaking some kind of rule. They're either like we spoke about earlier, Brother Eric King, who was assaulted, defended himself, and then gets charged with assault. And by the way, four cops assaulted him. It wasn't like one lieutenant that came up with him. Four different male cops jumped on him. Eric is a dear friend of mine. He's not a very large person. He defended himself. He gets charged with assault. So, you know, any kind of support we can give that literally, you know, stays the hand, so to speak, or literally stays the hand of prison authorities in assaulting somebody is obviously very important. When we send letters, when we send solidarity and support, of course, you know, internally to the prisoner, that means a lot, but it also is significant in terms of the prison seeing that support and the solidarity that exists. So it makes them sometimes think twice before they do some of the most horrendous activity. Also, it's very important that, again, I'm not saying anything to anybody I think that they're not aware of, but just to remind us, political prisoners have a lot of insight, a lot of understanding, because they came from the movements that we're all part of now out here. They came from that, and not only came from it, so had that historical and practical experience, but also in captivity, and this is true, again, across the board for all political prisoners, every day is ongoing, even in segregation, and there's often many years of control unit segregation and so forth, but even in segregation, let alone in population situations, there's study groups, there's organizing activity of other prisoners, social prisoners, there's literal work that the political prisoners are doing with organizations outside, writing analysis, essays, and so forth. So, I mean, this is a resource. Our political prisoners, they're not only our brothers and sisters, our comrades, but they're a resource for all of us in terms of, the work we do out here. It's not like two separate things. The work behind the walls, the work out here, it's a joint thing. And they're a resource for us, and we should tap into that as much as we can. And certainly those comrades are there, you know, willing and ready to support us. Certainly people like Sundiata, another person that's a dear comrade of mine, daily, you know, and I'm sure it goes on today. It was many years ago that we were in the same actual, prison, but daily, you know, he worked on activities and campaigns going on outside, and then, you know, jumped into the work, the collective, the organizing, and educating that we were doing inside with other prisoners. So this is like a daily thing. From the outside, you know, from the inside, the prisoner gets information and support. From the outside, we get understanding, analysis, oftentimes, you know, some ideological clarity, because these folks in those cells, I mean, whatever level of understanding and consciousness they had, and they certainly had high levels, but that's been increased because of the study and the work that they've done themselves. So that they're like resources to tap, and we should continue to do that. I'm not saying we're not, we are, but we should continue to do that. And of course, you know, just in general, I mean, these literally are our dear comrades, our brothers and sisters, whether or not, you know, you actually were in the same city or town or collective working with that person outside. But I mean, they are us. Any one of us that's out here doing work, you could become a political prisoner tomorrow. I mean, and that's happened, and it continues to happen. So they're really us in a situation that we can be of support to and that we can gain from. And so, you know, just wanted to throw some of that into perspective. Couple of thoughts as I've been watching here all afternoon and this evening, seeing David saying those words, I mean, it's so, it was so beautiful, so wonderful. And, I really understood that because, you know, I've only been out here about 7 months myself now. So those initial moments and hours and days, I mean, they're amazing. And my moments and days continue to be amazing as well. But to see him there for the first time in almost 50 years, you know, speaking to us, knowing that he's there outside, it's just so good. But at the same time, it makes me feel even more determined and more energized, you know, to work to get Sundiata out, to get Leonard out, to get Bill Dunn out, and all the other people that, you know, the names we're familiar with. I mean, people that have been in captivity decade after decade, as well as, you know, people like Eric King, you know, that maybe the numbers aren't quite as huge, maybe 7 or 10 years or something. But I mean, that work is and should be, and certainly for me it is, you know, kind of a core necessity in terms of any liberation struggle work that we do out here. And that's, of course, what we do out here, as they do in there. And I guess overall, my main thought, you know, covering this whole afternoon is, you know, the passing of our dear, dear comrade Maroon. It's certainly true, you know, to pass out here is, to pass out here is really important for all political prisoners. So that part is wonderful. But we need to make sure that no more of our comrades die in prison or die a week or two or a month or two after they come out. So let me leave it at that.
Power to the people.
Power to the people. May, you are muted, dear.
Well, power to the people. I just want to thank you again, Jan. Your emotion and your insights, so, so useful and valuable to us. I know I was like, the tears were coming my eyes when I was listening to the stuff about Symbiota. And yeah, it's, you know, there's the pain and there's the joy and the humanity of the situation. And that's, you know, the risk we have in leading active, conscious lives instead of living lives of fantasy. And so let's take those risks together. And one of the things that I just want to say about that is it really does help to be together, you know, affinity groups, collectives, joining with the organizations, getting on the RnB mailing list, which I will have to say, Bob Letter does a tremendous job of sending out just the right amount of information. You can go to our Facebook page and get connected from there. Anarchist Black Cross has just said, you know, they've got this great booklet that is like a booklet of information about the political prisoners. It's on the chat. Northeast Political Prisoners holds open meetings, I think, as I understand. And, you know, there's National Jericho and there's Spirit of Mandela.
Third, you know, Saturday of every month. Third Saturday of every month at noon, Spirit of Mandela, open meetings.
So join together. And also many of you are already in organization, goodness knows. So let's just keep in touch and not let any divisions separate us. So again, thanks to everyone, especially all the former political prisoners who were able to join with us and help celebrate, and all the activists who've sacrificed in their own ways to do this work. Thanks to all of you. Now we're gonna end with some culture again from the tribunal, and we're done. Take care till next year.
Meg asked me to say something about the music that's gonna end us out. So I just wanna also thank my dear R&B sisters, Meg and Elsbeth, for coordinating this. And again, all of you here, what an inspiring space. As we go to the mailboxes individually and send our letters individually, let's also raise a toast and have some yummy food and think of one another, not physically together this year, but together in all other ways. We're gonna end out the hour on two pieces of music. So we'll be done with talking as soon as I'm done, but we'll hear two things. The first is gonna be a compilation done by, again, some of the young sisters and brothers that part of Spirit of Mandela that actually put together this compilation as a prequel to the Tribunal. So it has the music of Strange Fruit and Billie Holiday. And we're going to get to hear some of the words of some of the greats, because we get to hear Brother Malcolm, Minister Malcolm X, Al-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz. And we're going to also hear some still with us, but we get to hear some of the words of some dearly departed, Sophia Bukhari and Geronimo G. Jaga Pratt. And then after that, the last piece we're going to have is going to be another piece, or piece by Bilal Sunni Ali, who reconfigured the old tune Stay to talk about how the political prisoners need to be freed. The first prisoner featured in Bilal's piece is Jalil Muntakim. He did this right before Jalil was released, but then you'll see some still inside prisoners spotlighted in Bilal's piece. And with those notes and musical words, we will wish you all a happy and a healthy and a safe, a revolutionary and a beautiful end of 2021, and a fighting, more successful 2022 when we free them all and bring them home. Lots of love. Thank you.
That we are part of an ongoing years, hundreds and hundreds of years of struggle against the slavocracy and the mentality of it. And I see it as us as being this continuation of this nation of people who were kidnapped, whose ancestors were kidnapped wrongfully. Brought to these shores against their will, and that we would have to come together as one.
Malcolm, just to prepare to go into the United Nations at this point and ask that charges be brought against the United States for its treatment of American Negroes?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Please. Yes, as I pointed out when I was during my traveling, that nations look, African nations and Asian nations and Latin American nations look very hypocritical when they stand up in the United Nations condemning the racist practices of South Africa and that which is practiced by Portugal and Angola, and saying nothing in the UN about the racist practices that are manifest every day against Negroes in this society.
The consensus is A, we must take back to the streets. It doesn't matter whether or not the person that is accosting your son or daughter, or my son or daughter, my wife, your husband, my mother, your parents, it doesn't matter whether or not they were deprived as a youth. It doesn't matter or not whether or not they had no background that enabled them to become socialized into the fabric of society. It doesn't matter whether or not they're the victims of society. The end result is they're about to knock my mother on the head with a lead pipe, shoot my sister, beat up my wife, take on my sons. So I don't want to ask, what made them do this? They must be taken off the street. That's number one.
What we have to try to get people to recognize and say, hey, listen, that's the show. You know, the real power behind this show, the ones who were really manipulating what's going on with this show, this movie that we're watching here called Life, right, is these power interests over here, you see? And so we need to concentrate on how they are manipulating the system. And if we can begin to let people start seeing that, I think it's possible for us to have a Poor and Oppressed People's Convention where we begin to draw up our own national agenda in a manner from which we can challenge the system in a coherent way that really, really affects the way people live in this country.
I mean, that's why when someone asked me about violence, I just find it incredible. What it means is that the person who's asking that question has absolutely no idea what black people have gone through, what black people have experienced in this country since the time the first black person was kidnapped from the shores of Africa.
What we have in common is a common enemy and a common struggle. The common enemy being the racist, sexist, colonialist, imperialist, capitalist system of the United States of America. A system that promotes and supports police brutality and murder of people of color and of other oppressed people. A system that promotes property value over human lives and dignity. A system that promotes the dollar profit over the rights of the people to decent housing, education, and employment. A system that utilizes racism as a tool to keep us divided and fighting amongst ourselves, and as a means of justifying the continued inhuman acts perpetrated against people of African descent in this country. Our common struggle is against the enemy that perpetuates these evils. Our common struggle is against the enemy that utilizes a propaganda war to criminalize our struggles, to demonize us, to make the world believe that our struggles are not just struggles, and the captured combatants, the freedom fighters, the captured comrades are not political prisoners, but criminals.
So Jay could get out on the street and avoid that COVID-19. The judge in this case set him free on the grounds of compassionate release. So Jay could get out on the street and avoid that COVID-19. Then on the darkest hour, Corona took over. Against the judge's first order. of that order.
Abu-Jamal
had hepatitis B that affected him severely. So a judge ordered that medicine be administered to him for his relief. Abu-Jamal had hepatitis B that affected him severely. So a judge ordered that medicine be administered to him for his relief.
Political